Much. It looks like everybody's getting in and getting connected to the audio. Thanks so much for being here. My name is Misty Rusk. I'm the Executive Director of the Free Enterprise Institute at University of San Diego. We are glad to have you here for session 10 of San Diego Angel Conference for eTrack. So tonight's on funding alternatives and options. And I'm just going to run through a few quick things or we turn it over to our keynote speaker. So quickly, if you haven't been with us before, the Free Enterprise Institute is part of USD's School of Business, and it is the home for student-facing extracurricular activities that have to do with innovation and entrepreneurship, the Brink SBDC, and the San Diego Angel Conference. So if we've got Diana or Rachel, anybody from those organizations who wants to jump up and share a little bit, now would be great. Of my setup, I can't see who's here tonight. So, all right, I will keep going. Applications are open. We've started to see applications coming in. We really are right at 4 weeks out. So it's 27 days and some hours. We'll let it run probably right till midnight. But to apply, go to the website, vsdangels.com/apply, which you'll see this page. And then there's a big blue button there that says apply, which will take you over to the Gust portal, which is the platform that we use to manage all of the deals. I don't want anybody to be surprised. So there's a $149 application fee. That's consistent. We haven't changed it since we started. And it covers your ticket to the main event. It helps to offset the cost of running the program. And for that, you get to have all of your information in Gust reviewed by at least some of the angel investors that participate with us starting the 5th of January. We couldn't do this without our great sponsors. So I want to give a shout out to Nextwork, our title sponsor for this year. And I think we've got Bianca Michelle here. And she's going to do a breakout room tonight. So if you haven't had a chance to explore what's offered by Nextwork, you might want to spend one of those breakout sessions with Bianca so she can share more about what they have to offer. And there's no way that we could do this program without this powerhouse group of partners. San Diego is super fortunate in the depth and breadth of technical support for founders like you. So if you are not yet working with an accelerator somewhere, or if you need a connection to any of these specific organizations, please let us know. It's super important to us to make sure that you get connected to these resources because founders should not be doing this alone. You should really put together a team, and this group of partners can be a powerful part of the team that you build. Quick overview of how things work. So as I mentioned, this is session 10 of the eTrack. We have just a couple more sessions before the application deadline. So we've got pitch deconstruction, nothing next week. So week of Thanksgiving, we don't have a session that Wednesday night. The following Wednesday, we'll do pitch deconstruction. Then we have due diligence, and then it's the application deadline. So December 15th is the day to apply. And then beginning in January, our investors start working on sorting the deals. And we've made some key decisions about voting and selection processes and some of those kinds of things. So that all starts in January with a wrap up on the 24th of March at the Hilton Bayfront, where we're going to do the finale. And there's a great team of people. So you've got staff, Chris Peters and I are the staff of the project. This year's co-fund managers, Brian Engelman and Sumner Webster. And then of course, the powerhouse fund management team that includes all of our fund managers up to this point and some other stellar accredited investors who jump into. So with that, those are my quick introductory comments. With that, I wanna hand things over to Brian Dirkmat. So Brian is a partner at Coeptus Law. They are a local boutique firm that I hope he'll tell you a little bit more about. They're also a partner and a sponsor of the San Diego Angel Conference. And we work very closely with them because they specialize in the space where you at. One of the things I like best about Coeptus is they will do flat rate services. So you know exactly what you're buying up front. You agree on the price before you get started. And with that, Brian, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Hi, it's a real pleasure to speak tonight. Misty did a good introduction. We're sponsors of this event, and we're very proud and honored to do that, and especially honored to speak tonight. Speaking on a subject that I enjoy talking about a lot and that I enjoyed working on a lot. So Misty also did a good description of who we are. We're a boutique firm that focuses on representing startup and early stage companies and investors that invest in those companies from formation. We do a lot of early stage financing, which is what we're talking about tonight. We do M&A work and intellectual property protection. And between those bigger high points, we handle many of the other kind of business transactions that a startup emerging growth company needs. So Misty asked me to speak tonight on the different forms of doing early stage financing. And how they evolved, and why might you pick one over the other if you're doing a financing right now? And then also just to touch really briefly on some valuation thoughts that I'll hit on at the end. So let me share screen so I can get my slides. Does that work? Does it look like it's working? All right, good. So early stage investing, how we got here. I'll just say, just as an upfront note, I've been practicing law since January 2002, passed the bar in 2001. And I lived through, as an attorney, I lived through the development that we'll be talking about tonight. But it was only recently when I was preparing this presentation that I took the chance to step back and actually review documents and review the history and kind of go over everything. It actually really opened my eyes. And so I hope it's similarly enlightening for you to see the history of how the different forms of investment have arisen and why we have what we have today. So we'll get right into it. So if you're looking at raising outside financing, there's several different ways, of course, and we'll talk about some of the other ways that don't involve equity, non-dilutive financing, straight debt, SBA type loans, or grants from the government, things like that. But if you're looking to an investor to invest in the company, what is the best way to do that investment? And I start out talking about common and preferred stock, because when investors are investing in the company, they're not generally interested in doing the other forms of investment where like straight debt or other things, because their only return is whatever the interest is on that debt. Most startup companies are extremely high risk. And so because of that extreme high risk, investors are looking for a much greater return than what can be accomplished with like interest on debt, for example. They're looking for returns like 5x to 10x of their money rather than what they get with non-equity type investment. So when you're looking at equity, this is pretty basic, but I just wanted to make sure I touched on it. There's two main ways for an investor to buy equity in the company, and that's either to buy common stock or preferred stock. So the way it sounds, common stock is common. There's nothing special about it. With common stock, you get one vote per share. You are entitled to receive dividends if they're made. And then if the company is liquidated, you're entitled to distributions. And that's about it. But if you contrast that with preferred stock, like the word sounds, again, it has all these preferences built into it, protections that are given. And investors want these protections, mostly because, again, they're investing, they expect returns. They also expect certain protections if things don't go well. And they're generally not involved in the day-to-day management or affairs of the company. And so they don't have control over the way the company is managed as merely a shareholder. So they want to build in certain things and control rights in these protections they get or special preferences. So one of them is they get special voting rights on certain types of matters, and those are often called veto rights. That means if the company wants to do something, if it's on this list, then the company has to go to the investors who hold preferred stock and get their separate vote. And if they vote no, of course, they're in a sense vetoing the transaction. So investors, when they invest, they want equity so they can get the potential huge upside, potentially 10x or even much greater than that. When they want equity, they want preferred stock. So when you're considering what is the best way to structure an early stage financing, really the question is, what is the best, most efficient way for the investor to buy preferred stock? So now getting into a little bit of the history. Well, today there are, five different choices when investors are investing in the company. But it's important to see, and I'll go over the history more, but it's important to note that before the year 2005, there were only two choices. And that's kind of surprising to learn because these other choices are so well known, you think they've been around forever, but they haven't. So before 2005, and indeed when I was practicing law in 2002 up until that point, the only choice for investors was either to buy common stock or to buy what's called Series A preferred stock. And I'll talk more about that in a second. And it wasn't until 2005 that convertible notes started being used. Then it wasn't until 2013 that what's called a SAFE started being used. And then about the same time in the middle of that, what's called Series Seed preferred stock was developed. And I'll talk about each one of these. So Series A preferred stock, and why not? So why do we have all these alternatives? Why wasn't the choice to buy common stock or Series A preferred stock? Why was that choice not good enough? So today you can find the Series A preferred stock documents on a website called nvca.org. So if you just Google that or just go to the website, they have a section called model documents. And you can find all of the documents that are typically used for a Series A preferred stock financing. There are a lot of them. There are at least six main deal documents. And each of those documents are very detailed, probably 30 to 40 plus pages long. So why not Series A for early stage financings? When I'm talking early stage, we generally know what that means, but I'm also talking deal size, like usually under $1 million. And usually pretty early stage in the company, first year or two. So the cost for, I'll skip to the bottom of the slide, the cost to do these documents with all of the detail that's involved in them, at minimum is 20K plus. The average for these deals tends to be 50K and upwards. So the cost, you know, if an early stage company is doing a financing of 300K or 500K, they certainly don't want to pay 50K to do the deal. So the cost can be high for early stage. Also, a lot of these terms are simply not needed at a very early stage. And then again, there's a quote from Jason Mendelson. He's a co-author of a book with Brad Feld called, Venture Deals. I have it on a later slide. But if you don't know of the book, I highly recommend it. He says, these documents are too complicated for 90% of the folks who are doing these deals anyway. And then there's this comment that there's a commitment to valuation. And I'll talk about that when I talk about convertible notes and safes, because when they were first started being used, there was no valuation. They eliminated the need to discuss valuation. So you could, for example, do a convertible note and you're not pricing it. And so you get this term today, like people say, I'm going to do a priced round, or I'm going to do a convertible note. We're not going to do a priced round until later. What that means is you're not talking about valuation right now. So again, why not in Series A? Because it's too complicated and it's too expensive. And so folks wanted an alternative. It wasn't until 2005 that an alternative started being used. So a little bit of history before 2005, there was a convertible note that existed for financing, but it wasn't used for early stage financings. Instead, it was only used in the concept of what's called a bridge note. And that explains why sometimes today when people are using convertible notes, they say, I'm using a bridge note. And you wonder if it's the first early stage financing, you think, what are they bridging from? And I guess you can reason today, well, they're bridging from like friends and family or just merely non-outside financing to their first kind of institutional financing. That's a back-end way of creating meaning to the term bridge note, but really the term bridge note meant historically or originally, it meant that it bridged from one financing to the next. So again, back when investors could only buy common or preferred, they would do a Series A preferred stock deal, maybe even a Series B. Then, and these deals were big and they took a while to do. So if a company was in the middle, if they had just done a Series B and they know they want to do a Series C later, but it might take a year or so to finally get around to doing that Series C or Series C, but they need money urgently now. Often the existing investors probably intend to also invest in the Series C round along with new investors. And the existing investors already know the company really well because they've done all the due diligence and all the investigation. They already have a relationship with the company. So they put in place a very simple document called a bridge note or a convertible note, and it's debt. So the investors loan the money to the company, and it has interest and it has a maturity date. And the intention behind this is the money will not be paid back as traditional debt. Instead, the money will be converted when the Series C is later done. The money that's invested under this debt instrument will, instead of being paid back as debt, it will simply convert and be used as purchase price money in the later Series C round. So these notes were intended to be temporary stopgaps or temporary aids for the money to raise a small amount of money while they were in between a Series B or C or D type larger financings. And because of this temporary nature, the maturity dates of these debt instruments were a year or less. And there was also a finance lender's law requirement that required the maturity date be 1 year or less. The investors were relatively certain that the next financing would happen. There were no fancy things with these bridge notes like board seats or information rights. The interest rate was very low because the investors were not looking to make money based on interest. They intended for the money to convert into preferred stock at the later round. And so the interest was merely there to kind of give them a little bit of a benefit for the time that the money was being held before it was actually converted into the Series C. So today, convertible notes have what are called discounts on conversion. They also have valuation caps. We'll talk about those later. But at this time, they didn't use those concepts. The discount is given to investors as a benefit for coming in early and investing early. So for example, if you do a Series C round that's priced at $1 a share, and investors put money in now, when the note converts later at the Series C, if there's a 20% discount, that means that their money gets to buy Series C preferred stock at 80 cents per share rather than a dollar per share, what the other new investors would be paying. So again, at this time when bridge notes are being used, there are no discounts on conversion. Instead, if the investors wanted some kind of kicker for coming in early, they would issue what are called warrants. And warrants are a lot like stock options. They give the investor the option to buy shares at a negotiated discount price. And so that would give them the kicker that they were looking for. So to conclude, just these bridge notes before 2005 were very simple documents that were intended to be in place for a year or less and had minimal rights, minimal terms. They also had minimal, I don't say it on the slide, but minimal reps and warranties because again, the investors already knew the company. So in 2005, when the investment community and the startup community was looking for an alternative to Series A, they pulled the bridge note concept off the shelf and used it for an entirely new usage. They decided to use it for the first time for early stage investing, for first money in. So they're really not bridging anything. And they call them convertible notes. So again, it's debt. It's a promissory note. It has a maturity date and it has interest on it. But all of the investors in the company, all of them intend for this convertible note to convert into when the company finally does do a preferred stock priced equity round. So when these bridge notes were transferred into becoming convertible notes in 2005, they were still super simple. They still had maturity dates of only a year or less. They still did not have discounts on conversion. They didn't have valuation caps, but they were brilliant alternatives to the problem at the time because they were a whole lot less costly to implement. They're simple. There was only one or two deal documents involved. So you could put these in place really quickly. You could get money in from early stage investors with the promise that they would be converted into preferred stock at a later date. So it was a great solution to a problem. Then as convertible notes were used over time, added features were put into these convertible notes to give investors more protections and just to evolve. So for example, discounts were introduced, and you arrive to today where discounts are usually about 20%. So those were used for a while. And then the concept of a valuation cap came along so that by the year 2012, in various surveys, at least 90% of all convertible note deals had valuation caps in them. And today I would say close to 100% have valuation caps. And what a valuation cap means in simple terms is if the investors are investing now, let's say they're investing $1 million. And let's say they intend in their minds that they're going to get 20% of the company for the million. But again, they're only buying debt right now, not equity. So they're not getting any percent of the company. But when they convert later, they're intending to convert and get the equivalent of 20% at that time. So the way they do that is the way you calculate the price per share and what percent investors get is you use the valuation. You probably heard pre-money valuation and post-money valuation. So pre-money valuation means what the company is worth before new money comes in. Then you have new money. So pre-money plus new money equals post-money valuation. So if investors are investing $1 million and they intend to get 20%, that means the pre-money valuation is 4 million. Because 4 million plus 1 million is 5 million, and the 1 million out of 5 is 20%. So they would add what's called a valuation cap on the convertible note, and they would state in the convertible note that when they convert their money and buy Series A preferred stock, they will buy it at a valuation that is assumed to be at a cap, and what we say it is today. And so they would often say, okay, the valuation cap is 4 million. That could potentially give them a huge benefit. Because if the company would later raise Series A and they were able to get a higher valuation because the company has done really well, let's say they get an $8 million pre-money valuation. New investors are calculating their price per share of the Series A based on an $8 million pre-money valuation. Whereas the investors under the convertible notes get to buy stock in the Series A financing at the $4 million cap. That means in effect, they get a 50% discount. So today, the way convertible notes are drafted is that the investor gets the best of either the 20% discount or the valuation cap, whichever turns out better for them. And there are actually an enormous amount of complications involved with the valuation caps because there are at least 2 to 4 different ways of calculating the conversion of the notes. And these methods are often not even talked about. And so investors often get surprised when the conversion happens. And there's a term called convertible note shuffle that I use a lot and that I've actually seen on the internet. You can Google it and you can find information about that. That's one way in which convertible notes have become very complex, is actually calculating the conversion with the valuation caps. Also, the finance lenders law changed in 2014, allowing notes to have longer maturity dates. So they would go now, typical notes, convertible notes have maturity dates of 2 or 3, sometimes 3 years. So they're in existence for longer periods of time. Sometimes these are debt instruments. So sometimes investors want to secure the debt with security agreements, securing all the assets of the company. That greatly complicates the deal. Then also, because the investors under convertible notes get the right to buy preferred stock at a discount price, then there's this concept called liquidation overhang that I won't go into detail about now, but because there's this difference in price that the convertible note investors pay for the Series A versus what the new investors pay, then when you actually create the preferred stock, the community now, what we do is we create what's called a shadow preferred, which is a different series of preferred stock for convertible note holders than what the new investors get. So now you have actually two different series of preferred stock. You have like Series A and Series A1. A1 would be for the convertible note investors. So that complicates things. Then also, of course, you can add into convertible notes, you can add other rights, you can enhance the reps and warranties, you can have voting veto rights, you can even add rights for investors to get a board seat with the company. So if you do all of these things, you're greatly magnifying the complexity of a convertible note. Then I'll just finally note that convertible notes have tax pitfalls. One is called the original issue discount tax, and it's calculated on the imputed interest that is earned each year that that note is outstanding. And the investor has to pay tax on that each year. So that's often a surprise. The other is a tax code under IRS code 1202. It's a brilliant tax code that states in general that if an investor holds stock in a C corporation and holds that stock for at least 5 years, and the company and the holder meet a few other requirements, when the investor sells the stock after holding for 5 years, then the federal tax on the gain of that sale is entirely tax-free up to a gain of $10 million. State law doesn't necessarily recognize this, but at least federal does. And that can be a gigantic tax benefit to have a gain of $10 million entirely tax-free. So 1202 can be powerful. I'd also note that the current Biden proposal intends to reduce the exclusion from tax to reduce it to 50% instead of 100% exclusion. So that'll take a bite out of that if that gets passed. But currently it's 100% exclusion up to $10 million. If you invest under a convertible note, you're not holding equity yet. You don't hold equity until the note actually converts. And so if the convertible note is outstanding for 3 years and then you convert to equity, and then the company has an exit only 2 years later, you've only held equity for 2 years. So you miss out on the 1202 benefits if you invest under a convertible note under that kind of scenario that I just described. So because notes became more complex over time, the community wanted yet another solution to simplify and reduce legal costs and reduce negotiation time. So Y Combinator, which is a accelerator program, it's very well known out of Silicon Valley, came up and produced what's called the SAFE. It's a simple agreement for future equity. And I'm sure the term SAFE was well thought about because it to create simplicity and to make it easy to negotiate, it strips out a lot of terms. And most of these terms are intended to protect investors. All the things that I talked about complicating convertible notes, most of those are stripped out. And most of those, again, benefit investors. So if you're stripping all of those out, what's the interest of the investor to do this? And, you know, trust us, it's safe. Go ahead, do it. So Y Combinator created this in late 2013, and as far as I know, has been using it for virtually all of their deals since then. They were the early adopters, and there was a lot of pushback from the investment community at first, especially outside of Silicon Valley. I remember speaking about SAFEs to Tech Coast Angels in 2017, and it was still a rather newish concept in 2017, and there was still some reticence. But I would say today that the investors at Tech Coast Angels are much more comfortable with SAFE, and I have done deals where investors of TCA have invested in companies under SAFEs. So they're much more accepted today. And I would say worldwide, they're gaining a lot of traction. The SAFE is another brilliant alternative to the problems of complexity and legal costs at the time. The SAFE is one short, standardized 6-page document. All the main deal terms are on the front page. And then the other kind of what you might say boilerplate or just, you know, detailed terms are on the following pages. So many times investors simply look at the first page to get the main deal terms. And again, the SAFE is drafted to not be changed or negotiated. So it even contains a statement in there if you use the Y Combinator template, it contains a statement that this safe is based on the Y Combinator template and has not been changed. So the intent of the safe is that you don't negotiate it or change it. I've done plenty of safe deals where we have changed the terms, so it can be done. But even when we do change the terms, they're pretty light. Some features about the safe is that it is not a debt instrument. So some of the things that the safe is basically a convertible note, but it strips out a bunch of things. And two of the main things that it strips out is that there's no maturity date and there's no interest. So it's not a debt instrument whatsoever. So that's in fact vastly different from a convertible note now, because it's an entirely different category of instrument. And because it's not a debt instrument, it removes a lot of potential liability on the company. It also removes a lot of potential leverage that the investor might have, because if a note is going beyond the maturity date and hasn't converted, the investor has some amount of leverage to negotiate with the company or coerce the company to give the investor certain rights, because the investor can threaten bankruptcy if the investor forecloses on the entire the debt instrument. So safes are treated like preferred stock in liquidation, meaning they're paid after debt, but before common stock. So they're not debt. They don't get the priority that debt would get, but they do have priorities to be paid before the common stock. I just make a note here. We can talk about it in Q&A or at a later time, but there's the safe came out in 2013. Y Combinator came out with a newer version of the safe. I think it was late 2018, September 2018. And it's called the post money safe. And that refers to how the valuation cap is described. Rather than using what's called pre-money valuation cap, the newest version of the safe uses what's called a post-money version. They do it to provide clarity, and it does, but it also has some traps for the unwary. So be sure to pay attention to that. As far as tax pitfalls with the safe, you don't have the original issue discount tax that convertible notes do, because there's no interest, but you potentially don't get IRS code 1202 treatment. Some have argued that you could get IRS 1202 treatment under a safe, but that has not been tested in the courts or in any official statements that I've seen. So I would say the likelihood that a safe does not get 1202 benefit is very high. If you read the plain text of IRS code 1202, it talks about equity, and safe is not an equity instrument. Although it does contain terms in the safe that is to be treated as equity. So it's still uncertain, and I would say it's likely that you don't get 1202 treatment under a safe. And so it's better to assume you don't. So you have the same problem. If an investor holds a safe for 2 or 3 years and then converts to equity, they may miss out on the 5-year holding period for equity. So there's yet a third alternative now for an investor to ultimately buy preferred stock. And again, when we started, we described that the choice was either common stock or preferred stock, and that investors want preferred stock. So when I'm describing a convertible note being used in 2005, and I'm describing a safe being used, the safe and the convertible note are mere proxies for what the investor ultimately wants. The investor ultimately wants preferred stock. But because Series A was so complex and time-consuming and costly to implement, these proxies were put in place to make it easy for money to come in. And then when we can afford the complexity later of doing a preferred stock round, then we'll convert your money into preferred stock. An alternative was created. Some brilliant folks thought, well, why don't we just simplify the Series A preferred stock? Instead of doing a convertible note or even a safe, why don't we just make Series A preferred stock a little more simple, a lot more simple? And this was actually developed before the concept of the safe came out. So it was developed as convertible notes were becoming more complex. So the community looked, what's a better alternative? And again, investors want preferred stock. So let's give investors an easy way to buy preferred stock right now and do an end run around the convertible notes. We don't need them anymore. We'll just buy preferred stock really simply. So the documents for this, the Series Seed preferred stock, are very simple. There's really only two deal documents. It's the certificate of incorporation and then what's called the stock investment agreement. It's really a stock purchase agreement. You can also, of course, use a term sheet. So if you use a term sheet, there's three documents. The good part about Series Seed is that important terms are included, like enhanced reps and warranties that are important to early stage investors. Board seats are included. MFN, most favorable nation rights, are included. Pro rata future participation rights are included. Drag along and other rights are included. So some of the major rights that are really important to early stage investors that you normally find in the Series A deal, they have been included in this deal. But again, it's greatly simplified, so a lot more simple than the Series A documents. And I don't put on this slide, but the Series Seed preferred stock documents are publicly available as well. There's a GitHub. Well, the guy who invented these documents was an attorney named Ted Wang, and he created a website called seriesseed.com. And you can still go to that website today, although everything has been transferred, and there's a link on that website to the GitHub site that contains the more updated versions. And then Cooley, the law firm Cooley, created a fork of that GitHub under the Cooley fork, and they've maintained it even more recently. And then, of course, you may know about Cooley's online website called CooleyGo, where they have a document generator. They maintain the Series Seed preferred stock deals on their document generator. So you can get up-to-date curated documents on GitHub or on CooleyGo. One thing also is that the safes now commit you to a valuation because you are doing a priced round. And then so people often still use the terminology when they're talking about, if they're talking about the choice, should we do a Series A or Series Seed? They'll often say, well, we don't want to do a priced round. We want to keep it simple. So we're going to do a convertible note or a safe. But all convertible notes today and all safes, but most safes today have valuation caps. And so when you're doing a valuation cap, you're doing a commitment to valuation anyway. So it's false to say that going to a convertible note or a safe doesn't commit you to a valuation. The benefit of the Series Seed is that, you know, with these two documents, the legal fees are greatly diminished. I often do Series Seed deals on a flat fee basis, and the flat fee is often 10 or 15K, much less than a Series A. And just for just kind of parameters, when I do flat fees, if I do a convertible note, the flat fee is often 7.5K, potentially 10K. Obviously, if you make a convertible note really complex, the fees can get up to 15K or even more if you want to make it that complex. But generally, convertible notes are about 7.5 to 10K in legal fees. Series Seed is generally about 10K to 15K in legal fees, whereas a safe is about 3K. The fees can also go up if there are multiple investors in multiple states, because you have to comply with securities laws in each state that an investor resides. And that can raise the legal fee and the filing fee costs. So back on Series Seed, the benefits are obviously that you get everything. The investor gets what they want. They get preferred stock. They don't have to use a proxy. The legal fees are low. And you get the IRS code 1202 tax benefit because you're holding equity. And so the five-year time period starts running the minute you buy a Series Seed preferred stock. And there's not the original issue discount tax problem. So I think it's a brilliant alternative. So you may know that safes and notes are more popular today than Series Seed preferred stock. And one would ask the question, why? If investors ultimately want preferred stock and they're not going to do Series A, why is Series Seed less popular than notes or safes? I have a theory. I don't know if it's true, but my theory is that convertible notes really took off and were a great solution. As they became more complex, obviously nobody liked the complexity. So when the Series Seed preferred stock came out, it was interesting. But they are more complex than a convertible note, and they do cost more in legal fees. So I think the community ignored them. Also, IRS code 1202 was not as important back in 2010. The tax benefit was either 50% or less, and it was not permanent. It wasn't until a change in the law in late 2015, so really beginning 2016, that the 100% exclusion up to $10 million was made permanent. And now, again, it might go away here very soon, but at least since 2016, the IRS Code 1202 has been, the benefit has been permanent. And it's my opinion that again, because it wasn't, 1202 wasn't as important, and because convertible notes were so popular, and when SAFEs came out, they really became really popular and they were very much simpler, that Series C preferred stock just got overlooked. And I think it's taken a while to become more popular, especially with the 1202 benefit now. And I would, so now ultimately the question is, after you've looked at all of these potentials, and if you're a company founder looking at raising money or an investor, you know, the question is, what should I go with? What deal is, what structure is best? So my first comment is kind of borrowed from that book that I mentioned earlier, Venture Deals. It's my opinion that if you're doing an investment of 500K to a million, the amount of legal fees you pay on a Series C deal is minimal compared to the benefits you get. And so the argument that you want to save on legal fees and you want to do a convertible note or a safe for a 500K or a million plus, I agree with the Venture Deals comment that it doesn't carry much weight, especially when you could potentially benefit from IRS Code 1202 tax benefit of potentially a million plus in taxes. When is it appropriate? I would argue that, I would also say though that I have represented clients doing safes for $1 to $2 million. Safes are used for large deals, 1 million plus, and investors like doing them. So there can be a reason. So I would say if the deal is 500K or less, that maybe a safe or a note is more appropriate, because yes, they are much more simple and much less legal fees. You can get them done very quickly. I would also say that if the investors in the company are fairly certain that the priced equity round is going to happen pretty soon, and I would say less than 3 years, less even than 2 years, I would say that a safe or a note is appropriate. I might also argue that I would think that the popularity of convertible notes is going to get squeezed out, that safes are going to become more popular for lower value deals. And I think that Series C preferred stock is going to become more popular when safes aren't appropriate. One final comment on notes is that, again, because it's debt, if the company is missing the maturity date, not converting, because the price round has not come as early as they expected, some investors enjoy having the leverage that a convertible note gives them. And I have represented clients when this is a major factor, and it can be a major benefit to an investor to have the leverage of potentially foreclosing on the entire company and bankrupting the company, unless the company does certain things that favor that investor over potentially others who have put money in. So that is a point to consider when looking at convertible notes. Let's see, we have about 13 minutes. Misty asked me to talk about valuation quickly. I'm not an investor, I'm a lawyer. I typically don't get involved in the valuation discussions, but I see it a lot, of course. And I'll just hit very quickly kind of the thought process behind valuations from my perspective. So first, just high level, valuations of companies usually follow traditional methods like a DCF analysis or other type sophisticated analyses. And there are, you know, financials, market comparisons, projections, and all these things. Well, for early stage startups, none of those are available. And so these traditional methods are not possible. And even if you try to engage in them, they're highly unrealistic. So then how do you set these pre-money valuations? How do you set the valuation caps and other things? Well, really what it is the investor is looking at what kind of gain do they expect? So for example, the investor has various options to put their money in to invest. They could, you know, a riskless rate of return in treasury notes, you know, fluctuates all the time, but maybe 2% annual rate of return. Corporate bonds, maybe 2.5%, 3% annual rate of return. Invest in a index fund, NASDAQ or the know, elsewhere, you might get on average over 10 years, you might get 8% or 10 or 13%. But if you're considering investing in a highly risky startup company where your investment is not liquid, your money is locked up for at least 5 to 7 or more years, company is developing, significant risk is involved, you can get 10, maybe 13% on a stock market with a good index fund. What would you demand for an early stage investment? Well, generally investors are looking to realize 25 to 30% compounded annual rate, which equates to about a 6x return at 7 years. And typical startups generally exit at about 7 years. So then you look at, well, if most of these are going to fail, then what kind of return do I want on successful companies? Well, I want at least a 10x return or more. So then the question is, what percentage of the company must I own today in order to realize a 10x return after 7 years while getting diluted in the process? So it just kind of works out that the investor generally wants 20% of the company. And so if the investor wants 20% of the company, if it's only a $500K investment, that creates a $2 million pre-money valuation. So that's about it that I have for now. I hope the review of the history was helpful to you and why we have the three main choices that we have today for early stage investing. We have convertible notes, safes, and Series C preferred stock. And I hope this gives you a good grasp of the differences and why you might choose to use one or the other. I really enjoy doing these things. I work a lot in this area. I'm happy to take calls if you'd like to contact me. So my contact information is there. Feel free to reach out. I'm happy to chat. And then also, I think we might have a few minutes or not for Q&A. And then also in the breakout session, I think we're going to talk about this.
Chris is going to manage a few minutes of Q&A here, and then we're going to have a quick break, and then we'll come back and go to breakout sessions.
Hi, Chris. This is Tom Skank. Hi, Misty. Nice to see you again.
Hi, Tom. Hi. What's your question?
Chris, thank you very much. My question is, when you take on a client, what is it that you're looking for? So you'll say it's worth your time and worth the investors or worth the founder's time to even try to look for investors. Do you do that kind of an evaluation before you say, yeah, we'll take a look at it? How do you work?
Oh, you're asking me as an attorney, why would I take on a client?
Yes. What things are you looking for?
Good question. Well, there's various things. First, is it a good client for me as a law firm? And your other part of your question, is this the type of company that should be going out to investors right now, right?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, so the client can be a great client for me, even if they're not intending to go out to investors right now. So for me as a lawyer, I'm just looking for a client that I'm going to have a long-term relationship with and somebody I enjoy working with and somebody who's doing cool things in the market. So a good long-term client. Then I, you know, as part of what I do as a lawyer, yes, I do engage in those conversations about whether you should be or are ready to look for outside investment. As a lawyer, I don't necessarily advise them on the business. So I advise them more as a lawyer and how to structure the deal. And are you corporate, you know, as a corporation, are you ready for this? And how do I get you ready? For example, maybe we need to clean up a bunch of stuff if I didn't form your company for you. Maybe we need to get all your documents in order, or maybe there are other potential liabilities that need to be fixed and cleaned up. So I can help with a lot of that kind of stuff. And then I can help position the company. First, decide what kind of investment do they do a safe note or series seed and why, and then prepare them for doing that. Yeah. So I do help in that a lot.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
I will call you later, Brian.
Great.
Thank you.
Oh, I have to mention.
Call you later, Brian.
Benton. Love to hear from you, Benton. I'm happy to take calls from folks who are just to chat about this presentation from folks who are out of state, but because I'm licensed in California, I can only represent clients who are located in California. Kind of frustrating, but it's the reality.
Thanks for the caveat.
Yeah,
I do have a question. So we see a lot of convertible notes. It's probably 70% of the deals we do at TCA, as you know. What happens, and this is more for the entrepreneurs in the room, what happens at the end of a convertible note term, 18, 24, 36 months, whatever it is, if there's not an event that triggers the conversion?
Yeah, that's the leverage I was talking about earlier. Yeah. So what happens? It's a good question. And I have worked with clients in this scenario. And I would say a large percentage of convertible notes end up in that scenario. So when you go on Y Combinator, they have a safe primer document. And I believe it's still in the safe primer. I know it was discussed when the safes first came out, but one of the comments was the reality is, they said, look, most convertible notes go beyond the maturity date. And most investors do not foreclose on the note, because what are they going to foreclose on? Some foosball tables and some massage tables and whatever else is lying around in this startup that's going down the drain. So yes, when they hit the maturity date, there's a discussion between the investors and the CEO running the company. And often what happens is there's nothing that the investors do. They simply extend it out. And then it just sits there continuing to accrue interest until it finally converts. That's the short. We could talk a lot about what happens, because there's a lot, but that's kind of the short answer.
Okay. So reasonable investors understand there's not much to claw back except a collectible foosball table, which, you know, I'd put a high value on that. But realizing there's not much in the way of assets, how does that conversation go and what usually comes out of it?
That it's usually a conversation. Okay, what are your plans to do the priced round? How likely are you to do it? How can we help you? What resources do we have as an investor? Can we introduce you to more people? What can we do to help this company get the priced round? And obviously, of course, what are you, CEO, doing? What are you not doing well enough that you need to do? Do you need outside coaching? Do you need other help? Because we need to convert this. So that's generally the discussion. Then if things are just not looking positive, I've represented companies are in the situation where then the investors say, all right, it's looking unlikely that this is going to convert. We want some compensation. So let's negotiate a deal where you start paying us X dollars per month to pay this thing down. And I have seen that, or other arrangements like that.
Okay, so that's the leverage you talk about for an investor. There's no other way. Okay.
Yeah, and I just want to conclude the thought. I don't think I mentioned it, but when the safe came out, that's what they said about the safe. They said, let's be real. The maturity dates are always blown and the investors never foreclose on them. So why don't we just remove the maturity date? And then let's be real also, the investors don't really look to gain based on the interest rate. They're not looking for the interest rate is minimal. So let's remove the interest as well. Let's just simplify this.
So that's probably a good tip for all the entrepreneurs here. There's no reason to jack up your interest to 10 or 12 or 16% thinking that that's going to attract investors that wouldn't otherwise be attracted, right?
Exactly.
What are you seeing as the market rates right now for C notes?
Oh, probably 5 to 7%. I would even say that a founder promoting a higher interest rate might even be a red flag. Like, why are you, do you not intend for this to convert real fast? No, we want it to convert very fast and we don't want to make money off the interest.
Brian, I was going to ask, this is Amy Duncan. So maybe the company isn't going down the drain, but maybe they've turned into a zombie.
Yeah.
And so, if the note has come to term and the company is doing fine, but there's clearly they're never going to exit. Have you seen something like that happen? And then what would be?
Yes, I have. Yeah. That's where they work out a payment arrangement.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And it can include, you know, before you CEO get paid, we need these payments to us as investors. Cause there is money. So the company has revenue every month and maybe even progressing, doing better every month, but it's on such a slow track that it's unlikely that the equity round is going to happen at all or anytime soon. And so that's where you work out these kinds of arrangements. I could add, since there's no other questions, I could just add that I've seen scenarios where there are convertible notes, and there are also price rounds that have taken place. And the convertible note was either not converted, but more likely it's a true bridge note where there was a price round done, maybe a Series A or a Series B, and then a bridge note was put in place, but the bridge note actually never bridged to like a Series C round. So you have preferred stock that's been issued by the company, and you still have convertible notes that are outstanding. Then when the company is doing poorly, and the investor holding, so all the investors now, the Series A investors, the Series B investors, and the convertible note investors are all talking to the CEO of the company, asking the CEO, what are you going to do? You know, we need an exit. Well, in that scenario, the convertible note holder has significant leverage over the Series A and Series B equity holders, and can often get better terms, get better payback terms than the Series A and Series B equity holders.
Thank you, Brian.
Yep.
So at this point, we're going to go ahead and take a 5-minute break. So we'll be back around 6:35 or so, and then Misty will talk some, and then we'll go into breakout rooms. I'm going to share my screen and leave you with a quote for those 5 minutes. Designing a presentation without an audience in mind is like writing a love letter and addressing it to whom it may concern.
All right, everybody, we're going to go ahead and bring it back in. I'm afraid I say this every week, but like this is one of my favorite sessions. The next thing that we're going to do, like in a normal live environment, we would have set this up as an expo and tried to do some kind of tabling event where you'd have some time to go around and get to know some of the resources that are available. And so instead of doing that, we've set up some breakout rooms and invited some of our favorite partners to come and present to you tonight. So without endorsing anybody specifically, I'm pretty sure I've got rules that say I should not do that. We wanted to open up the breakout rooms. And so before we open up the breakout rooms, I'd like to do sort of a quick around the room here so that you get a little a snapshot of who we have available for breakout sessions tonight. So Brian will do a breakout session in case you had additional questions you wanted to ask about some of the things he presented or about, you know, structures or evaluation in general. And then Spencer, do you mind turning on your video and mic and giving a quick introduction about your room?
You bet. My name is Spencer. I used to have a private consulting business helping clients raise capital via debt. Sometimes there are options available for startups. Depends on a lot of things. But before that, I worked in commercial lending for many, many years. I don't have the link to my company at the moment because I've recently taken a position with one of my clients as their CFO. But I might be able to stay here with Misty over the next few weeks and help out on the bank side of things. Let me know if you have any questions.
All right, so Spencer will be in the bank lending room. Next up, Debbie Chen, you wanna talk about what you're gonna cover in your room?
Hey everyone, my name is Debbie Chen. I'm the founder and CEO of Hydrostasis. I'm also one of the finalists of the very first SDAC. So been around and saw, you know, the amazing things that SDAC has become. So I'm really excited to come back and speak about the friends and family round.
Perfect. Thanks, Debbie. And David Goslin.
Hi, everybody. I'm David Goslin. I'm a partner at DBB McKinnon. We're a CPA firm. And for the past 6 years or so, I've been heavily involved in the equity crowdfunding industry since it was legalized around that time. So I'll be talking about some of the various ways you could equity crowdfund and maybe some reasons why you would or why you wouldn't. And we'll have fun chatting.
Thanks, David. DJ Anderson.
Hi, I'm the operations coordinator for Tech Coast Angels San Diego. And I'll just be talking about how TCA works as an angel investment organization with startups, what we're looking for, and how we can help finance your next round.
Thanks, DJ. Mike Kren with Connect.
Everybody, Mike Krent. I think I want to go join some of the other breakout sessions. Actually, I'm Mike Krent. I run Connect. Spend my days basically helping early stage companies connect to VCs and work a lot with post venture back CEOs and VCs and connecting them to one another. So happy to talk about anything related to getting access to the venture capital community. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for being here, Aurelia.
Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Aurelia Alvarez. I'm with Mission Driven Finance. And in the breakout session tonight, I'll be covering number one, how to leverage debt if you're trying to minimize dilution. And then secondly, the importance of selecting a values aligned investor. And we're local. Thank you.